This is Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk. Here are your hosts, Dr. Tim Slekar and Dr. Johnny Lupinacci, educated educators talking education.
Welcome Friday night, Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk, educated educators. Yeah, we're talking education. 855-752-4842, 855-752-4842 is the number for you to jump in. Give us a call right off the bat. We're fine. Stephen, we haven't heard you out there giving us a call from, was it Stephen from Green Bay, who's usually heading to bed. Stephen, come on, man. We've been waiting for you. And we know the pillow is calling you. Dude, give us a call, man. You can talk about whatever you want. The other thing too, Johnny, we're reminding people again, if you're not able to catch live, right, you know how to fix that? Download the Civic Media app. When you have that Civic Media app, you can pick up Busted Pencils wherever you are, as long as there's a cell signal. It doesn't matter what time. And you know what? And even all of the great programming on Civic Media is available through that Civic Media app. It's one of the greatest things about this. But, you know, for our listeners, though, yeah, you're like, hey, I can't catch Busted Pencils because I'm going to be. Well, do you have your cell phone? Then download that Civic Media app because you never have to miss Tim and Johnny. Speaking of Johnny, how are you? How are you doing, buddy?
Good, man. You know what I was experimenting with, too, today, based on while you're plugging the app and talking about how you can find Civic Media's, I was telling all the different smart speakers in my house to, you know, tune into this station, tune into that station, and so, you know, whether you're listening on Mad Radio or the Shaw, you can tell your smart radio to pick it up and it just streams it. So I was just like, well, we're going with the Civic Media apps and stuff. I was playing with that a little bit today. And sure enough, it worked. I'm not going to say their names because whether they're Mac or PC affiliated, they have a very specific name. They both coexist in the same space. It's almost this weird form of technological polygamy here in this household. I have both the Mac and the PC living companions living in the same space, coexisting and not quite fighting with one another. And I try to pit them against one another all the time. But they both do a great job of picking up Civic Media shows. So you can tell your smart speakers to grab the show. But Tim, no, it's Friday. I digress because it is Friday afternoon. It's been a doozy of a week. It's spring. It's sprinter in most places. Yeah. You know, we call it sprinter. It's like they teased a little spring and then the snow started coming back, which is a good thing. Fresh water falling from the sky, as annoying as it is helpful to us as summer comes in and dries out. So we like some precipitation. We'll deal with it. That's a little bit of a cold version of it. But other than that, Tim, you know, it was a great week of shows. Educators amplified. A lot of schools going into spring break coming up. So just all kinds of things, you know. It is season changing. We had yes, to keep off, but, you know, but now we're actually in spring. Feels like winter. It's spring. I don't know, Tim. It's Friday.
I don't. What do you think about the weather, though? It's just like, yeah. But I was talking to a colleague who said, you know, this is the first year. And this is a guy who really likes to golf. He's like, he has golfed for 12 months straight. First time ever. He has not had to take months off for winter to golf because he has been golfing in January, February. And he's like, you know, usually that never happens. Usually you put the golf clubs away sometime in October, November. You won't pull them back out till the end of March again. He's like, man, I have golfed every month. So not sure what that has to do with education news, but it is Friday. As we say, thank God it is Friday and it's Busted Pencils. That's what we're doing. You know, bring in the show. Johnny, you talk about, you know, a great week of shows.
It's public. So you thank whatever you want. Like it's public education. So you could thank God. You could thank any, the gods, the beings, the anything. You just be thankful. Like I said, Friday, that it's the end of the week and it's Busted Pencils wrapping it up. So we're here for you.
Thank goodness. Thank you. You name it. Yeah. Thank AI. If that's where you want to go with it. Sure. It's 855-752-4842.
So much.
855-752-4842. Johnny throwing insults right away. But you know, thinking about I just think about last night's show. Just, you know, Nancy Flanagan in, and you know, she comes in with her blog, Stranger, Teacher in a Strange Land, and just puts out this question: core democratic values, you know, in schools, really, do we want them? And people are saying, like, of course we do. And you're like, you know, if you listen to the show, and I'd say go to the Civic Media webpage, click on the you know, the Busted Pencils podcast from last night and download this and listen to it. Because as much as people listening are saying, I can't imagine that democratic core values are something that could be potentially a dicey subject. And it's like, well, it is, you know, in today's world right now, the idea, you know, first of all, from the simpleton arrangement of somebody going, well, when are we going to teach core Republican values at the same time to give it equal time? It's like, yo, dude, we're not talking about Democrat, the party, Democrat. We're talking about democracy. But to the point where you go, Johnny, but there's some of these democratic core values, and like the diversity one. Do we always have to do diversity? You don't get to, as you said, Johnny Lupinacci, you don't get to pick and choose the assortment of core democratic values that you like and move the other ones off to the side because you don't like those. You get them all. And in fact, in public schools, that's what we're supposed to be doing. But the reality is that actually there has been a mounted offense to teaching, and it's very offensive to teaching core democratic values, particularly around ones where people go, I'm not sure I like that one that much. And they get really worried about it, Johnny.
Well, I mean, I'm confused. What are you saying? It's offensive, like as an educator and a person who values core democratic values, or are you saying that people are finding it offensive that core democratic value, or both? It's just.
Well, I think the way
reactions.
The way you said it is that there's both. People are offended. Especially, I think it's the one thing where you go, well, you know, yeah, you guys are throwing that diversity stuff in there. We want to outlaw that. It's like, okay, but you know that while you're attacking diversity, equity, and inclusion, which is kind of a little pivot into some of the news stories I want to share on a Friday night, but the attacks on diversity, equity, and inclusion, when you point out, Johnny, that diversity in the core democratic values, right? You put it in. It's like, okay, so you're attacking democracy. Like,
I'm going to be a little hard on folks, because I think oftentimes self-proclaimed liberals are even representatives of the Democrat Party, because I get that when we say core democratic values, if you're not like a social studies teacher, or you're like steeped in the kind of conversation around what constitutes a democracy, you know, we hear democratic, and it gets not to make an excuse for a legislator, like an actual politician who should know the very differences of it. But in everyday conversation, I happen to have sympathy for understanding that it gets heard, you know, in my neighborhood or out at the barbecue, we're talking about it. And it's like, well, I don't know, are you talking about Democrats? Because I'll tell you what, there are Democrats who don't hold up core democratic values. You were bringing that up too. You're like, hey, whether you're Republican or whether you're Democrat identifying, both groups need to take a closer look at these values being nonpartisan. These are just
right.
Like they, and so there is a little bit of a language game going on here at the Democrat Party.
I know.
And we could even do like a whole episode sometime on the history, is like what we used to know as the Republican Party became the Democratic Party. Like they just flip. But you know, the whole two-party system gets confusing and divisive. But the bottom line here we're talking about is like democratic values, core democratic values don't belong to one party. They're supposed to be the thing that is sort of baseline for all of us. That would mean multiple parties. That would mean they would be Green Party values. That would mean
absolutely.
It would be libertarian values across. If you're participating in a democracy, you may favor some, but you can't have them prioritized in the decision making, like in the actual actions taken. They are held at equal value. And this is difficult for, I would say, to be a little critical of progressives, radicals, progressives, left leaning folks. You know, sometimes they have had the tendency to prioritize a few of these. And I picked on YouTube. No, you're not actually one of these Marxist guys, but I know plenty of them. And I have friends who are like, I got friends from all walks. Right. And I pick on these guys a lot because they favor equality over freedom. Like they want to control, right? That's part of the core definition of Marxism, right? Like a dictatorship of the proletariat. I'm not down with, I don't think Tim, you're down with.
No.
We're into the popular sovereignty end of things where it's government for the people, by the people. I like equality. I think, you know, Marx's pitch for like communism is like based in some idea of equality, but then how do we get there? He says, well, we enforce it and we take away liberty and all of these things. So freedom and liberty at the expense of the other two, no thanks. So I come back around to it. So it's like, so we need to be like, you and I, we're here chopping up these core democratic values. This is like, no matter what camp you're coming from, right? We're asking like, and we're not alone. When I say we, Tim, and I mean like people committed to core democratic values, which ought to be anyone in politics or especially in public schools. We're talking like not only social studies teachers, but all teachers kind of are striving to structure their classroom in support of the development of skills that helps us graduate from each grade level better and better and better at valuing all of those core democratic values, all eight of them at equal value. So you know, that means you can be conservative and value those eight things. You could be radical liberal. You could be any of those pieces. And you might struggle with wanting to prioritize one or two of them, but you can't put them ahead of the equality of all of them.
I like the way you said that. It's a struggle, and that's okay. And in fact, you know, the reality, it's a democracy, and we're struggling, we're wrestling, we're having this. But the reality is, though, is we're not going to say, let's move one out because we don't like that one anymore. That's not what it happens. And as you say, it's a public school, and we're going to put this out there, the public schools and their connection to democracy, it is the place where we say that the responsibility, along with learning your math and reading, yes, we know it's also that's required in school, but public schools, building the civic mentality of the citizens, is just what the public schools are for. It's Busted Pencils. It's a Friday night, 855-752-4842. You know, give us a call. But Johnny, coming in, man, hey, the attacks on diversity, equity, and inclusion, yeah, they keep coming. More when we get back. What we're always doing here, Busted Pencils, we're waiting for you to give us a call. It's Fully Leaded Education Talk, educated educators talking education. 855-752-4842. Give us a call, jump in there. Core democratic values, and we will be hitting core democratic values quite regularly in this show, because, you know, hey, Busted Pencils is about public education, it's about democracy. We make sure that we're always refreshing everybody's memory. Johnny, Alabama governor signs law banning school DEI funding. For anybody who's like, DEI, what's that, Tim? That's diversity, equity, and inclusion funding. Alabama governor Kay Ivey signed a law on Tuesday that will ban public schools and colleges from funding diversity, equity, and inclusion efforts, continuing a nationwide push by conservatives to remove such programs from education systems. Johnny, you were saying like this seems like more of a college issue, but here it is very explicitly saying public schools included. So if you're doing, and Mike thought about this, is going, all of the efforts that we've been putting in towards culturally relevant pedagogy, right? Which is, guess what? An inclusive pedagogy, an inclusive way of teaching that recognizes the diversity of people in your classroom and bringing that up. And so, and the research says it's good. It works really well. It's usually really beneficial. It's now banned. So literally banning in a public school the teaching of, and I'm wondering, going, is this really then saying, so I can't even teach my kids to appreciate diversity? And you, Johnny, keep throwing out going, however, Tim, you know, diversity is what keeps us actually together. It keeps the world going. Without diversity, we'd have serious problems. Johnny,
I end up being in a tough spot with this one, Tim, because I mean, right now, and I think these are important things, diversity, equity, and inclusion are all, I mean, two of those, diversity and equity or equality and equity together, although they're not the same thing, we can expand equality to include equity because justice is also a core democratic value. But so two of these, this popular acronym at the moment, are core democratic values. So it is related. And inclusion, you know, it sort of is the action associated with valuing those two things, diversity and equity. And, you know, so we'll be inclusive. We'll include, you know, a diversity of people in equitable ways. You know, it is important, but it is also a narrow view of what diversity brings. It's only emphasizing cultural diversity. And the thing about it is diversity is a condition upon which everything exists. Remember we talked about like, give it 101 definition. Difference is a, you know, diversity is a condition of difference upon which everything exists. Nothing comes into existence or exists at all outside of its relationship to other things. That referring to the multitude of things in one place or around the world or in existence is the term diversity. So valuing diversity is really important. It's what makes democracy difficult because it means everybody has a voice and every voice is valued. Well, that means a lot of voices. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's possible. And that's also why we have that condition of the common good. It's also why we spend so many years, ideally in school together, figuring out how to be better at making complicated decisions, to apply important skills and information that's out there to making decisions together in the interest of the common good. But DEI politics right now, Tim, are taking up a lot of space. And I don't think that that's a bad thing. I mean, I think it's showing that it's important, but it's also showing that it's under attack because it is important. And then it's also distracting because you can't ban this stuff. Like you can't ban diversity. It exists. You can make it difficult to recognize and value it. And I think that's what this legislative effort, particularly in Alabama, is hoping to do. But you cannot ban it, even if you make it against the law to talk about diversity per se. You still have all kinds of different things going. So it's like, it's one of those things to say like, Tim, I don't think air is good for people. So I'm going to ban air. You know, it's almost that ridiculous when we break it down as such a core essential thing. But what they're really saying is they're using that the language around this to really say, we want to continue to have our public spaces benefit some and exclude the majority. Right. Or include people in it only so far as though they benefit the majority moving up. Or I mean, like the political majority, which is a few people. So that's really what it's saying is like, and I like the articles you sent me because they're saying, hey, it's like this explanation, like we're making, like, hey, can't you see how ridiculous this is? So in Alabama, saying when you do this, you're going to really harm progress made in special education because, you know, these are diverse children's needs. Ability falls under this term. So we're going to be excluded. And I'm going to be really blunt and read through. I'm going to read against the text for a minute here. What's not said is part of the argument is saying is like, hey, don't you see this is going to hurt white kids too? This is going to also hurt wealthy kids too, because wealthy, like ability cuts across all ethnicities and all. And yes, they're right. But it's like, hey, do we really have to point out that it's hurting? Oh, don't. Like your argument is also hurting your privileged group that you're representing in order for it to matter. Yes, unfortunately, that is the case that, you know, these articles kind of speak to me. If I cut right through it, it's like the inclusion part is going to be harmed. But that's not really what these attacks are about. These attacks are about making sure Black and brown families don't feel comfortable in schools, making sure that white folks in schools don't learn about that it's not okay to make folks feel uncomfortable or why they might feel uncomfortable, you know, the kinds of histories or reasons why what would be banned in schools under this. That's really what they're trying to attack. They're really not trying to be like, you know, against diversity, equity, and inclusion. They're just trying to find polite ways to say, we don't want anything different than what currently has benefited our version of how things should be.
Yeah, we don't want this pivot to recognizing some form of, you know, especially diversities that I don't like. I mean, but Johnny, you made a good point, though, too, is the connection to inclusion, special education inclusion. And there are some, you know, more conservative think tanks out there going, ho, 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 wait a minute, Lupinacci, Slekar. We're not going after special education inclusion. You're reading our bills wrong. The inclusion we're going after is the mandated inclusion of, you know, those other. Wait, that doesn't sound right that I'm saying that I'm against including other. Yes, you are saying you're not including. I know you didn't say that special education is. You didn't outlaw special education by outlawing inclusion. However, when you outlaw inclusion and you find that there are some special education families, teachers, and students feeling like this feels like an attack on me, well, come on now. Don't act like you're sitting there going, that's not who we meant to go after. Well, here, how about this part? Why did you mean to go after anybody? What in the world is that about? Why are you going after people? Busted pencils, fully leaded education talk. I tell you what, that's what we're here for. We're going to come after you when you decide you're going after somebody like that, because that's just not the way we do things. It's public education, man. It's democracy. It's busted pencils. We'll be right back. Hey, that's what it is. It's Friday night. It's Busted Pencils, and help is on the way. Help is always on the way. 855-752-4842. Educated educators talking education on the only fully leaded education talk show in the world. It's Busted Pencils. And that's what we do here, Johnny. You know, DEI, a little bit of the attack on diversity, equity, inclusion. Some of the conservatives are a little bit annoyed that special education people are worried that they're attacking the inclusion of special education. Conservatives are like, no, hold on, special ed people. Your inclusion is still fine. It's the other inclusion. Oh, and I was saying during the break. And so when you put that out there, the defense is that, well, yes, we are banning some forms of inclusion. We don't want that type of inclusion. Special education, you're still included. However, if you happen to be potentially a minority student who has special education needs, you can talk about your special education needs, but don't talk about your diversity issues if you're that student. And see, the complications, it just gets out there and it's just like, no. So realize that being against diversity, equity, and inclusion, but it reminds me of going all the way back to Monday when we had Dr. Kevin Kumashiro on the show talking about, you know, that we were celebrating in Wisconsin the inclusion of Asian Americans and Hmong Americans in the curriculum for Wisconsin. And then we did talk a little bit about the bans on diversity, equity, and inclusion. And Dr. Kumashiro reminded us going that while technically the reality of these laws actually being enforced, and he said, hey, that's not really the point anyway. The point is to get people riled up. And as you just said, Johnny, you know, we can't ban air. But boy, if we can fire up a lot of people to be in favor of banning air, well, then that's great. Whether we can actually do it or not doesn't really matter as long as I create the hysteria and I get the people moving. And so banning these things, while they, quote, might not ever be done, it really does energize the base.
And it's a chilling effect. I mean, that's in the articles you sent, but also in the news frequently right now, as we're hearing that teachers and, you know, educators and folks, you know, in those political positions to, you know, decide how am I going to teach these core democratic values in ways that, you know, don't create massive controversy. Well, there's always going to be some controversy. We shouldn't be avoiding that. You know, also put into context, it's Friday. Let's go big a little bit. You know, okay. We always, as educators, whatever our political views are, you know, want our classrooms to be places where young people of any age, learners, are engaged in inquiry, in active learning, like thinking about information that's out there, processing it, and sort of making decisions based on good information. That came up yesterday in the show around the importance of truth and trustworthiness. Well, there's also an overload of things. Like, part of me, Tim, is just a little frustrated at, like, we're in, not you and I, but the news here or the media sources covering education are really focused on these issues of, like, what's happening at higher ed, or, you know, EI, is it something we can have in classrooms or not? It's like, these are things that are important to our whole country. Why are you putting it on only classrooms responsibility to do it? We shouldn't be arguing about this. And you know, future generations will look back at this moment and think about generations ahead of us, the students that we'll have and their students as they become teachers, will look back and say, and they were arguing about this important thing, DEI. Yeah, it was important. They were arguing about this where wars were going on. I think, you know, producer Anya said this a couple of days ago, like there are generations who are like, dude, you're talking about our wages lost a century from right now. Well, we're focused on, like, how are we going to mitigate climate change, right? Mm-hmm. And how are we going to figure out a world that we are in right now and in the near future? And so, you know, Tim, big in the news this week, great resources for teaching about the violence in Israel and Palestine, a Zen education project. It's part of Rethinking Schools, you know, unofficially and officially at times, partners of both Tim, your, my classroom, but also of the show. It's great resources out there about how to teach about the violence happening in Israel and Palestine right now. So, you know, we can give a plug on that. We'll hope to get some educators through that are talking about these things. But also, Tim, you know, our media outlets are dominated right now with some of these things that it's like, hold on. There are bigger things that I can't help but think these aren't just distractions from. Right? Like, how do we figure out how to end war anywhere when we are arguing about this fact of, like, does inclusion actually include, you know, everybody, or is it just a factor of special education? Because in Alabama, you know, they're passing this bill that bans DEI and is against inclusion, but now we're really worried about it. Because we're saying, oh, now it's going to hurt special education. Well, yeah, what'd you think? You made it harder to include people with different abilities or different backgrounds or who look different. But you didn't say, because it's actually not, like, okay in the world today to say, hey, I'm actually just really racist. And I don't want people who don't look like me or believe the same things as me in the same space as my children. That's really what those bills are about. You know, and so I've just sort of, like, I'm going to take a page of out of Educators Amplified. You know, we have Teacher Hallie and Teacher Joanna on Wednesdays, and just get regulated and remember, like, we can be different in the places we are. Let's not believe all the hype and get sucked into it. Let's just do differently in the things that we know are good and the things that our children in schools right now care about and are asking us questions about. And almost every teacher I talked to this week said, Johnny, I'm teaching social studies, or I'm in my literacy unit, or I'm here, and I'm not sure exactly how to teach what's going on in regards to war and unjust conflict in Israel and Palestine. And I said, you know what? Me either right now, but let's be co-learners together, and let's get information, and let's figure out how to do this as educated educators who care about democratic values. And a threat to democracy anywhere is a threat to democracy everywhere. Right. So, folks, if you need, before we dig into it on the show, if you need resources, go to Teaching About the Violence, Zen Education Project, Teaching People's History. Great stuff on all kinds of backgrounds and histories, really thoughtful teaching resources. And, you know, we'll come back to that because that is a trending thing in education. Might not be in the news, but it's on the street. It's in the community.
You said, and we're going to devote a significant amount of time to that when we really can. You know, Johnny, though, you made this, you know, we're banning DEI or banning this. And, well, guess what, though? Another bit of news this week. House Republicans want to ban universal free school lunches.
God, I'm starting to hear ban like a curse word. I'm gonna ban you from saying ban pretty soon. Oh, it's banning this, banning that. Sounds a lot like fascism or a little bit like a dictatorship somewhere.
Well, you sit there and go, really? Somebody is banning food. You're in support of banning food. Yeah, the last time I checked, being a biological organism in this current reality, or in this world, this planet we call Earth, requires that to maintain your life, you have to eat. We also then, apply that to education, and the research is pretty clear. In fact, it's not pretty clear. It's exclusively clear that when you eat, you'll learn better. And when you don't eat, you don't learn better. And so the reality now that we're going to literally debate whether or not we should ban free food,
Well, yeah, it's free school lunch programs that are under attack here. We had a whole show on it a while back. It was a couple weeks ago, which is really great because we talked about like one of the conditions of being a good learner is having like your basic needs met. Like you're hydrated, you're nourished, and you've rested. And what we know for a lot of kids actually around the world, but especially here in the United States, right, in our schools, which should be shocking. And in fact, international educators that visit our country to learn about our education system, one of the most shocking things that they talk about often is, I cannot believe how malnourished our children are in schools, like how much lack of attention it is to not just the base need that every kid is fed and fed well. This right. is sort of, but Tim, I'm going to back up and really simplify it on Friday, right? Here we are again talking about, why aren't we talking about these imminent conflicts that are happening everywhere that are disastrous for children, right? And families and schools, so our peers in other places, but also we're talking about the same kind of logics that are proposing bans on diversity, equity, and inclusion, or the actions affiliated with those, with that acronym. You know, the same logics is basically saying, we know, I'm going to just read against the grain and just cut through the jargon. I know, well, not me, but if I have these logics, we know that if you don't have good nourishment, you can't learn and do well. We like that design is basically saying, for kids experiencing poverty, for kids who, you know, disproportionately don't have access to food, we don't actually want you to learn. We just need somewhere for you to be and to suffer and to fill some spots and for us to count and make money off you. So we're going to keep you here. And this is what our good friends, again, another plug for a topic for the show. The other thing that people who visit our country from international, you know, systems of education and other places come and they think, how could this be a democracy, right? How could you value these things? And how could your schools be so much like your prisons? And why do you have so many people in prison, right? Well, there is great researchers out there who talk about the school to prison nexus. So, you know, the other thing is like, that's kind of the message we're sending children. And that's really what this Republican push, the House Republicans that want to ban universal free lunch. Shout out to listener Brandon. You sent me a text, you know, that said, hey, you guys talk about free lunch. Did you see this? Well, of course, it's constantly under attack. Why? Because if we provided nourishment to all these kids who we're including, right, to all these diverse children from diverse socioeconomic status, diverse cultural backgrounds. Who cares what their citizenship status is in the country? Their children here learning. We're all on one planet. We're here in this country. We're pro-democracy. If they were fed well, you know, they would do well. And if they did well and learned these things, then we would have a very different world. So these are intentional bans that are about maintaining racism, maintaining classism, and maintaining really, I can't get past that there's just not a like, almost randiness for torturing young people.
What's coming next, Johnny? But, you know, okay, the defenders, though, are going to say, okay, you two, you're taking a headline and blowing it way out of proportion.
Oh, yeah.
We're against universal free lunches because guess what? there are lots of kids in schools who don't need a handout. And this is what we're talking about, Tim and Johnny. We're not talking about taking away the free lunch program for kids in poverty. We're saying we're against feeding, but you're saying you're against feeding everybody.
Yeah.
I understand that, you know, some people can pay. I get it.
But you know what that shows us? That shows us that they're acknowledging that what people who can't afford food right now are being fed is unacceptable for their kids. So what they're doing is they're validating the fact that what we currently do for those who need it is not okay. And they're almost strengthening the argument for universal food for children in schools, because what they're saying is no way, not that is unacceptable. There's no way. I mean, we talked about it, Tim. We disclosed we were in that line. You know, our listeners have called in and shared what it was like to be that person who's called up to the front of the class, you know, to remind you, remember, you get this ticket today for your lunch. And it was like peanut butter and jelly on bread. Or it was a slice of cheese on bread. It wasn't the same lunch even as everyone else. If we were lucky enough to have the same lunch as everyone else, you know, people were like, oh, it's stew day. You know, it's goulash day. No one wants this. Well, that's
hamburger gravy.
So, you know, it just means that it would require that the quality went up. And that's also a good thing. You know, I'm here saying like,
I'm saying, the quality, we want the quality to go up. But you know what, Johnny, it makes me think too. It's just like, wait, that doesn't make me think. It makes me absolutely understand the reality of what's happening here. When you don't want to feed kids and you're saying, you know, yeah, we don't. And you know that its effect is, as you said, minimal, if any, learning. Well, and if we're teaching if Slekar and Lupinacci are going to teach core democratic values, we're going to make sure that their kids can't eat, because we want to make sure those kids don't learn those core democratic values. That's one way we can go after that. And, you know, they're probably going to sneak in diversity, equity, and inclusion in their teaching, too. Yes. Busted pencils. Fully leaded education talk, educated educators talking education. Yeah, the number 855-752-4842, 855-752-4842, watching live on the Facebook, live on the Twitter or the X. Some people call it X. I don't know. You know, the YouTube, you're checking it out, you know. Text us, though. Let us know what's happening, you know, right now. But if we possibly can't get through, we'll figure that out, because
we haven't given up on you, callers. We know there's been some tech difficulties throughout the week. We had, you know, some different producers in running the boards, and we'll figure it. We'll figure it out. If you've been trying to call in and you're getting channeled into some hold somewhere, we're figuring it out, and we appreciate you listening, and we'll get to you. We promise. If it's not tonight, then it's Monday on the show or whenever you're listening again. But we appreciate you, and you're part of us here at Busted Pencils. So thanks for being a listener. Tim, man, I got thinking about this too.
Okay.
You know, we were on this. You were talking about the bans and the bans on this, and then the bans on lunch. And I was like, oh, wait, that's right. We're banning lunch. We're making it harder and harder for kids. But let's come back to something. We talked about NAEP. Right. The National Assessment Educational, you know,
progress,
you know, these high stakes standardized tests that, you know, are part of the impetus for why busted pencils even exists. Right. It's like the opt out and like, what the heck with these tests already. But here we are almost 20 years later, still battling tests. And one of the things, just to connect dots for listeners, why we get so fired up about connecting these conversations around, whether it's banning DEI or don't say gay, like don't say gay or don't support all these attacks on children, right? They actually have numerical implications. And what I mean by that is there was an economist report that talked about lost wages and all these things because of lower test scores. And we kind of joked about it, like how ridiculous it is. But let's just connect a few dots of that bring food, school lunch, diversity, equity, inclusion, and all of the things we're talking about tonight together. And that's that most actuaries or people who predict like a need for an industry and business can can gather, and I'm going to simplify complicated math, they gather all kinds of information to make predictions about whether or not, you know, we'll need more airports, or we need bigger, larger hospitals, and they inform business. They ought to be informing government also, but they inform, you know, the decisions that go towards investing in these things. Well, there's something that there probably shouldn't be in a democracy, and that's a prison industry. So there are people who invest in incarcerating people. Like the whole prison system is both, you know, public and privatized, and increasingly more privatized, like our schools, right? But what one of the factors that we know is highly looked at in the projections and the arguments for the building and expanding of prisons are fourth grade reading scores and math scores. We know that if a fourth grader does poorly on these exams, the actuaries and the people who do the projections know that that's a high percentage likelihood that they can be counted on needing a prison bed. Now, that's not because of those fourth graders. That's because of the system that we have. And that's how critical those that they do well in school is. Right. And that's not just saying let's make sure the fourth graders read better. The fourth graders are reading great, and it's also important. But one of the things, Tim, we can look at too is, like, we know that it's hard to be a good reader. It's hard to learn if you're malnourished and if you don't have access to food. It's also against human rights. But in our country, it's getting harder and harder to stay nourished. It's getting more and more expensive. We have more and more families struggling to make ends meet and to meet the needs of growing learners. So our public system does absolutely nothing right now, in my opinion. I mean, there's little things, but they don't do enough. And efforts to do more are constantly shut down or proposed to be banned by primarily Republicans, but it expands further than that. I'll just call it by people who hate kids.
There you go.
Don't say they do, but it's like, don't, you might not hate your own kids, but in general, you kind of behave and make decisions like you hate kids. But that also sadly to say, have interests and investments in the prison system. And so there's a real, I'm going to call it, there's often a real conflict of interest when you're saying, well, I got to vote this down because universal health care, but universal food is going to mean less people in the prison that I make money on.
I'm investing in. Oh no.
And there's a one-to-one connection on a lot of policymakers and investments being tied up in private.
Oh man, there's a challenge out there, Johnny, you just put out there for some data people out there, some data mavens who want to jump in there and just look at that, you know, the connection between how many policymakers. So this effort to ban universal free lunches, how many of those who voted for the ban on universal free lunches, how many of them have investments tied up in the reality that they'll make more money if the conditions are right that allow people to potentially end up in prison? Do they have investments in the prison system and that they're voting for free lunches to be banned? Whoa, there's got to be somebody out there right now who's going, I could dig that up. We know you can. We know that's why you listen to Busted Pencils. We know you're out there. We know it's out there. We
need a chance to bring it.
We know we got the listeners out there that want to do it. We know my neighbor might even want to try to do it. The answer is yes. Of course, we know that. It's Busted Pencils. Johnny, man. Again, what a week. Dr. Kevin Kumashiro starts off the week. Tuesday, man, we do some incredible news about, $31 trillion in lost wages and no inventions because of eighth graders' math scores, educators amplified, teaching us how to get regulated, Nancy Flanagan, core Democratic values. And here we are Friday. The week is over already, Johnny. The show
I know, and I wanted to ask you about something, Tim. I wanted to ask you, we're gonna run out of time tonight, so we might have to make time next week because it's coming up pretty soon in an important election. Referendums, we talked about them here on the show before. I think we need to do a little bit of that next week, especially say yes to MPS.
Yes, I was gonna say yes to MPS.
We got to talk about what is that. Like, I mean, I've read through it, but I bet listeners are also, you know, interested, and we got to get the vote out for referendums across the state. We got an upcoming election. So next week, can we talk a little bit about, about that?
I think so. Actually, I'm going to put a hint. I put out a pitch out there, too, for Bob Peterson, Mr. MPS. See if he wants to come on Busted Pencils. Busted Pencils.
Yes,
thanks for a great week. Yeah. Thanks for a great week. We'll see y'all back on Monday.
Peace in the Middle East.